So for this episode, I'm here with Councillor Sue Shanks, the Green Party Deputy Leader for Brighton Hove City Council. Welcome back. So it's been a while, hasn't it, since we last spoke, a few months actually. How are you? All
I'm
good?
I'm fine, yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Going to be talking a bit about the vaccination drive, which is really important. I know the Brighton Hove City Council has been doing a lot of work, and it seems to be have been working. I've been to one of these mobile vaccination units myself for the second jab, and it was worked perfectly. Just tell us a bit about why it's important to get vaccinated and how people can get either their first or second jabs.
Well, the whole reason that the government are unlocking more things is that there's a high percentage of people now being vaccinated, and it does mean that you're not so likely to get really ill with the virus, although you can still catch it and you can still be hospitalised, to be honest. But, you know, that's the other reason for keeping safe in other ways. But it's really brought down compared to, say, last winter when we hadn't got the vaccine. It's really brought down the number of people who are ending up in intensive care and really ill with it, because we've still got quite a high rate of people actually testing positive for it. So we've got vaccinations. You can walk in now. Most of the people who haven't been vaccinated yet will be in the younger age group. There's the Brighton Centre, Brighton Racecourse and St Peter's Church at the moment, and that's, you just walk in. So yeah, it's easy to do. We have been doing a lot of other mobile vaccination buses and things like that around the place, and it's just encouraging people that you know who haven't got round to it, or it's been difficult to get the time to do it, or they've been worried about it. Because I mean, I've had both jabs. I'm sure you have not, Matt.
Yeah.
And it's really a painless operation, and we're all vaccinated from our birth for lots of things. So we all get our children vaccinated. It's the way that we stop things like smallpox, which used to be completely, endemic and a horrible disease, and measles as well. It's how we've managed to beat them. So this is why it's so important generally.
Exactly, yeah. And what's nice about the one on the seafront I found was that it's along Brighton seafront, and you can, it's not really, you're just enjoying the sun if the sun's out. So it's you don't mind queuing up, do you, when it's like down on Hove Lawn?
No,
so.
And there is parking as well for people who live further out or can't get there otherwise. But obviously it's very easy to get to Brighton Centre.
And it's gone pretty well, hasn't it, the vaccination drive in Brighton? I mean, Brighton Centre seems to have been working really well. I accompanied my mum and she got hers done at Brighton Centre. I've been to the race course for the first jab.
Yeah.
Seems to be working pretty well as well.
Yeah, I had mine done at Brighton Centre. A friend of mine has been volunteering there. They've had a lot of voluntary support. And I think, the whole vaccination programme nationally is going very well. Brighton's got a younger population, so our figures for numbers of population have sort of been lower, but now that hopefully younger people are getting it done,
that
will go up.
Yeah, what about, we're unlocking now, aren't we, pretty much, as we speak, in fact, Sue. So what's your feelings about that in terms of, because we've got, as we speak, fairly high numbers in Brighton, haven't we? I think low hospitalisation rates as we speak, but high numbers of cases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it is worrying, really. And I think if people, I certainly still going to wear a mask when I go on a bus. I mean, the bus company are asking to still wear masks, going into shops, going into pubs. I mean, outdoors has always been pretty safe in terms of catching COVID, as long as you're not, very close to people. I think just maintaining that bit of social distance that perhaps we used to not worry about, I think everybody's a bit more cautious now, if they're standing in a queue or if they're waiting for the toilet somewhere. I think there's a lot still that, I think we should preserve that. I mean, we're going to be, there are other things that come along, like the flu later on in the year. So I think we do need to preserve that, and washing our hands, all the things that we've been doing, and just being a bit sensible about it, really, because it's still, as you say, it hasn't gone away. We've got a much higher rate. We've got like 460 per 100,000 at the moment, and this time last year, I think it was, we were worried a bit later in the year maybe that we were going to be over 100, because that would have sent us into a different
tier.
Stays here, they were calling them at that stage, weren't they? So now, we've got a lot higher rate than that. Obviously, people aren't quite so ill with it. And I think also, there are better treatments, but still, it's still there.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, long COVID, I'm not a clinician, but obviously long COVID is something that is an issue now that we didn't know about then as well. So that's going to be something going, you know, which the NHS is going to be dealing with in years to come, by the looks of it.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So yeah. I think, yeah, if that's why we don't, you know, now we feel like we've done a lot of hard work, we've looked after ourselves, we've locked in. So this is not really the time, in my view, to go, oh, let's forget all about that and go back to how we were before.
Yeah. The economy, it seems to be recovering fairly well from what I can see. So last weekend, pretty packed. Yeah. It's the staycation element, I think, that's really helping to get the Brighton economy back, and if we're doing it safely, we want that to happen, don't we? We want people to go to the shops and etc., because we want to keep it the vibrant place that it is, and also it brings in taxes as well, doesn't it?
Oh yeah, I mean, it's you know, the city is well known for visitors, you know, particularly sort of short trips and stuff, but I think people are coming perhaps for longer, you know, because they can't go abroad, and actually at the moment, why would you need to? You know, the weather's absolutely fabulous, isn't it? So you know, we've had a lot of, it's that balance, isn't it, between being a city that residents live in and also being open to tourists, because, you know, my ward, St Peter's and North Lane, there's a lot of Airbnbs and a lot of residents aren't happy about that because it changes the nature of the, you know, the street. So there is that balance to be had. But I think, you know, certainly it's good to, I'm not going to go abroad this year. But
I know that you've got this new sports strategy as well there at the Brighton Council. So the swimming pools are opening back up as well, aren't they? And people can do the different sports activities. And the parks have been very well used, I've noticed, including mine at East Brighton Park. So people can get out and about and get active as well, because that's pretty crucial.
Yeah, and cycling, you know, there's a lot more people cycling, aren't there, and walking. And I think it's often surprising when you think, oh, I've got to, you know, how long will it take me to walk to the shop? Actually, when you do walk to the shop, it often takes you a lot less time than you thought it would, if you see what I mean, by the time you've parked and, you know, if you're going on short journeys. But obviously, also the upsurge in sea swimming. I mean, I've always sort of swum in the sea. I've swum in the sea a lot more now and more during the colder months as well. And I think there's a lot more people. Obviously, people still need to be careful and safe and not go too far out and be careful of the conditions.
Yeah.
And paddle boarding, I mean, we bought a paddle board. I haven't actually, it's more my husband's thing, because I prefer to swim. But, you know, there's a lot of paddle boarders out there as well. There. So there's a lot of upsurge, I think, in people using the sea more. You know, people have always sat on the beach, but I think they're going in the water a bit more.
Brilliant, yeah. That's good to hear, yeah. I know we're going to talk a bit about what's going on at the committee stage as well. Do we know when the committee is going to be fully back yet or not? Is that still to be decided? Because I know that
they've... No, we're pretty much fully back, really. There's a special ETS committee, Environment Transport Sustainability Committee, on, I think, next week. We've had the full council, which was smaller numbers, but from... My committee's, the Health and Wellbeing Board, is the 27th of July, and we're going to have the board mainly, and the voting members of the board, and then other people sort of videoing in. So it's going to be a bit of a hybrid. I think we're still going to maintain that with officers videoing in. If they've just got to give a report, it makes sense, really.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how it looks. I haven't really tried to look from outside, but a planning committee's been... We've had two or three planning committees now where we've all been there.
Yeah.
So it is starting to get, you know, we're being sensible. We're all taking tests before we go in. We're wearing masks. You know, we've got barriers up. But, we're starting to get back to that.
What about Health and Wellbeing Committee then? What's going on there?
Well, the next one's at the end of July. We've just got a new committee, really. So we've got a combination of... We have, at the moment, we've got 5 CCG members for the old committee we had, and 5 councillors, and we've changed that, and we've now got 2 CCG and 3 from the different hospital trusts, so plus extra representation from the voluntary sector, so 2 members from the voluntary sector, Health Watch, normal sort of officers. So it's a changed committee, and the idea is to try and be much more inclusive across the different aspects of health, really. But the main thing we have is our health and wellbeing strategy, which we published last year. And, you know, that sort of takes the board through the next 2 or 3 years, and we're just developing really how we're going to measure things, because that's the thing. It's all very well to have a strategy that says, oh, we want to obviously improve health equality, you know, and get people more active and all those things, but how are we measuring that, and how are we making sure we're doing that?
That's quite crucial, because I mean, health inequalities are probably going to get more. You know, they're going to get larger, aren't they, probably because of the lockdown?
Yes, and I think COVID's sort of shown that it affects people who live in, you know, more crowded housing. Yeah. We've been able to. So, yeah, I think that isn't a big issue, but it's always been an issue. I mean, when I was back in the 70s at university, I remember, you know, looking at the report then about it. It's not, you know, it's a general equalities issue, to be honest. And if there was much more wealth equality, then that would improve health equality.
But yeah,
that's a bigger issue, I suppose.
Yeah, I'm going to leave you there for the first half. Joining us for the second half, I'll be speaking a lot more to Deputy Leader of Brighton Hove City Council, Sue Shanks, a lot more about the committee work and what she's been getting up to. So back here for the second half of the vote with the Green Party Deputy Leader from Brighton Hove City Council, Sue Shanks. Welcome back, Sue. And we're going to talk a bit more about the Health and Wellbeing Committee. And there's a lot going on there with reform as well.
Yes, I know. Obviously, we've had the merger of hospitals, but we've now got the new NHS bill, which a lot of us aren't very happy about. But it's a national bill, so we'll have to learn to work with it locally. And there's going to be a presentation on that at the board on the 27th of July. So that will give more information about the integrated care boards which are coming. In some ways, it sounds a good thing. Obviously, we want to integrate adult social care with the NHS services. But, you know, when you reorganise things, when everybody's already under a lot of stress and, staff, certainly in the NHS, you know, changing people's jobs, changing the way things work, it all seems a bit, in my view, you know, the wrong time to do this. Also, we haven't had the proper adult health and social care bill, so we don't know, you know, the future funding for adult social care is still completely, we still don't know what's going on with that. So we're still, you know, there's a lot of stuff that still needs to happen with that. And but yeah, we will be looking at how this affects us locally, really. I think, you know, people have been working well during the pandemic between the NHS and adult social care to make sure that, you know, people are coming out of hospital somewhere, or they're going to be assessed at home, or they, you know, they're getting that sort of support properly. And that has worked, certainly at the moment, it's working well.
So I mean, most people wouldn't even know there was an NHS bill going through. So just briefly, I mean, what are these integrated healthcare boards? Are they replacing the CCGs, the clinical commissioning groups?
Yes, so the people who already are now called sort of executive director of CCGs, they're all going to be having to look at what their new roles will be. They already have been the integrated care systems, looking at how we integrate care across Sussex. And I mean, people are worried as well that there's a sort of more emphasis on privatisation.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily say that in the bill, but, you know, I think there's already a lot of the NHS is run by the private sector. And, you know, allowing one of the things is not having to have always go out procurement. If you've got a contract coming up, being able to give that contract without going through a competitive process. Now, you know, I don't actually think, personally, I used to work for local government. I don't really like the idea that we outsource all our services. I would much rather we did a lot more of that in-house, and the same with the NHS. But, you know, that's been going on for a long time, that there's been competitive tendering. And in some ways, you know, if we can give it to keep it with it in-house without having to go out, or if we can give it to a trust without having, that's a good thing. But if you can just award a contract, as we know, during the pandemic, too many contracts had just been awarded to people that people knew, really.
Exactly.
So that's a concern.
So that's something to look out for. Just recap on this merger. Obviously, it's Sussex University's NHS Trust now, I think, did I get that wrong? What was that merger that took place?
The Chichester, wasn't it? The hospital in Chichester?
Yeah.
St Richard's?
Yeah.
So that's come in under the West Sussex Hospital Trust merged with the University's Trust. So it's, I think well, there was obviously a business case made for that, and people are often distrustful of mergers in case we lose services, you know, sometimes. But sometimes, obviously, bringing things together is helpful as well, so we'll have to see how it goes. But
What else is going on with the Health and Wellbeing Board? Is that do you think your workload's going to increase? You probably put off some news, some kind of items during the pandemic, didn't you? I would have thought, and just kept to the kind of the priority items.
We've been having a lot of meetings all the time about COVID. It would be nice to be able to not have meetings about COVID, but you know, great, still here. We're looking at the Adult Learning Disability Strategy on the 27th, for example, which disability goes across both ours and children's services, because sort of managed by children's services, because we didn't want there to be a cut-off between people with learning disabilities when they got to 25, and then so, but those are sort of jointly looked at. So there's a new strategy for that. There's Health and Wellbeing Board new terms of reference I mentioned before, and also an update on our needs assessment across the city and outcome measures. So looking much more about, you know, what actually are we measuring and expecting from the strategy, because it's great to have a strategy, but you need to know if it's working or not.
Yeah. What about mental health services, Sue? Are you going to be looking into those? Because I can, they're going to be in need, I would have thought.
Yeah, they are. It's going to be a big thing, isn't it? I'm sure it'll be, you know. But one of the Sussex Partnership Trust is on the is now going to be part of the board on the Health and Wellbeing Board, so that'll be good. So we'll have somebody from those services. And we had a presentation last year, actually, I think, before we, or during lockdown, from the research that's been done into looking at how CAMHS is working or not working for young people. I think that's, you know, that's one of the major issues, isn't it? Is the thresholds that we have to get help are often, you know, it's really difficult to get help until you're really bad, until you're at crisis. And that's, you know, we really want to put in much more early help and intervention so that people don't have to reach crisis point before they're seen. So that's going to be a big challenge as well in terms of the NHS generally, because there's so much of a backlog of operations, etc., and work. But that's the aim.
What's going on St Peter's and North Lane Ward then? That's quite it's quite busy at the moment, isn't it? Because obviously you've got a lot of retail outlets in that area.
Yes, I mean, they're all busy. I think everybody's, you know, we put in some more, there's a lot more sort of outdoor cafes situations because the government relaxed its rules on licensing. So, you know, areas have been, you know, using the fine weather and the opportunity to put pavements out, to put things out on tables outside. I think one of the things that residents get upset about is, you know, Deliveroo drivers going down streets and, you know, at all times of day and night, and people parking badly to deliver stuff, and people sit on the beach and order a pizza, and they sort of don't remember that, you know, somebody's in somebody's street, there's a motor car or a bike going fast along it to get them their pizza. So we have had a few of those sorts of issues. Generally, I think, you know, there's a lot of new building as well. So there's a lot of, we've had some new planning applications. So we've got quite a lot of new building, and we're getting some 106 money for that. So looking, for example, the area of Providence Place off London Road.
Yeah.
You know, we're getting some money for that from the Longley development there. So those sorts of issues, how we can improve, know, the area. But we also, like, you know, we just had the festival there, so people saying, oh, it's very noisy, or we need to restore the grass. People love Valley Gardens, don't they? So that's really good.
They
that's
seem to, yeah. And it worked well with the Brighton Fringe Festival, Sue. I have to say, I was down there for the at the Warren, and it worked perfectly well. To be, it's a great venue, actually, to be fair. So it does. I think that whole redevelopment seems to have worked pretty well.
It has. Yeah. I think some people are concerned now about, you know, putting it back. Once it's just finished. But, and, you know, the museum has had a great exhibition, the Barry exhibition recently I just went to. Yeah. And so, you know, I'm sure that people are coming to the city. I met somebody when I was looking at that who was, you know, she'd been down for the weekend. She'd already been once, and she'd gone back to the exhibition for a second time because she liked it so much. So,
yeah,
you know, I think there is a lot going on. It's obviously very busy, and people just need to be, you know, think about other people, I suppose, and that people not only work and you know, holiday here, but they live here too. So,
yeah.
You know, that's always the balance, isn't it, to take?
Yeah. North Flames, just before we go, I mean, there doesn't seem to be too many empty shops around there, to be fair, and there's been a few there that have kind of changed into something else, so which I've noticed as well. So it seems to be recovering fairly well, I would say.
I think so. I mean, it's not, you know, I mean, I obviously get involved in some of those discussions. It's not my sort of specialist area, but certainly walking around there, it seems pretty good. And we'd encourage people to, you know, shop local and actually go to the shop, really, rather than get somebody bring something to you, which, you know, if you can get out and about and browse the fresh fruit, you can choose more, you know, you can choose better fruit, can't you, than if you get it delivered to you in plastic. But anyway...
Yeah,
that's just,
exactly. So, and just with the councils, I guess we looking back to. Do you know when the council will be fully back like it was before post COVID? Do you reckon that would it be this year, or it's too early to say?
Well, I think we're going to be sort of. I think the working from home thing has worked really well for a lot of people, and when you think about the number of meetings that we used to rush around to, and you know, travel to get to. I think there will be quite a lot of meetings, certainly, that, you know, between officers or councillors that aren't public meetings that we will hold still virtually, and people will still work from home if they want to, and, you know, we're working that out, really. But the public meetings, the council, you know, the public-facing meetings will be back in September, but certainly in sort of, you know, when we start back properly then.
Brilliant.
Yeah, we can come along and see that.
We'll leave it there. All the best, Sue. Thanks for joining us today, and all the best for the future. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Bye.